afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. This is, sorry, for those of you who don't know me, my name is Jean Kelly. I'm a chair here at the British Irish Chamber. And my day job is I'm a partner in LK Shields, a law firm in Dublin. So we are really pleased that Professor O'Sullivan has agreed to speak with us on related to AI. And I'm going to give you a little bit of an introduction to him in a moment. But first of all, thank you all for coming. Thank you all, committee members and the guests. We will have the format for this afternoon is we're going to give the floor to Professor O'Sullivan, who's going to give us a presentation in relation to AI and the regulation of AI and what bit of horizon scanning, to use that awful term, as to what that's going to look like in the next few years. We're then, you know, you can ask questions in the chat box, which will be made available there, or alternatively, when we come to the end, when we come to Q&A part, you can use the hand up signal on Zoom. So without further ado, I think I will introduce Professor Barry O'Sullivan. He is an award-winning academic in the fields of AI, constraint programming, prescriptive analytics, ethics and global policy, and he frequently contributes to global track AI and cyber-related diplomacy efforts. In addition to that, he is a founder, co-founder of Stimul.ai, which I hope I'm pronouncing correctly, but the last two letters are .ai. He is a full professor at the School of Computer Science and IT at UCC and a member of that university's governing body. He's also founding director of the Insight Centre for Data Analytics at UCC. And he has won so many awards that I'd be embarrassing him if I was to list them all out here. But without further ado, I'm going to pass on the mic to Professor O'Sullivan again with our renewed thanks for his generous giving of time to our committee.
Great, thank you. So that's a real pleasure to be here, and hopefully you can see those slides okay.
Yes, they're here.
Yeah. Super. So brilliant. So I'm delighted to be here. And as Dee mentioned, I've been doing a variety of things in AI over the last number of years. And I suppose while I do a lot of scientific work, I'm also doing a lot of policy work. I've been doing policy work for about 10 years. I think it's very important to do policy work as a scientist. I think it's important to, I don't think enough scientists do policy work. I think it's really important. So I've been fortunate enough to do a lot of things with the European Commission over the years. I also do quite a number of, a variety of things on what's called track two diplomacy, which is, I suppose, formally speaking, is the concept of back-channel diplomacy. It allows governments and state states to engage in discussions that are difficult to have formally. So one of the big ones that I've been involved in is the development of a code of conduct for the use of AI in military settings. And I've also been involved in codes of conduct on the weaponization of AI in terms of ransomware and so on. And so it's very interesting, the kinds of progress that can be made by through these sorts of channels, which is very, very interesting. So so I'm going to give you a sort of an overview of AI, sort of where I see it. And I guess just it's important to talk about the upcoming AI Act, or the AI regulation as it's called. And I just want to give a little bit of background as to where that came from and the thinking behind it. One of the big things that one needs to understand about AI is that Amara's law applies, and Amara's law says that we overestimate the impact of technology in the short term and underestimate its impact in the long term. So I think when the iPad came out in 2010, you know, we could not have imagined, you know, where that would have been, you know, 10 years later. And I can remember buying the first iPhone that I bought way back, you know, whatever it was in 2003, 2004, and hacking the thing to work in the Irish networks, and look where we are now. We're stuck to the thing. So I think we never envisaged that kind of world. So it's one of the reasons why we talk about AI so much these days is not because AI in general, is actually because of a subfield of machine learning called deep learning, which has had tremendous impacts. So these two gentlemen won the ACM Turing Award in 2018, which is essentially the Nobel Prize in Artificial Intelligence. Yann LeCun, Geoffrey Hinton, and Yoshua Bengio. And that was for their work in deep learning. And I suppose one of the interesting things about these individuals is that they have one foot in industrial research and one foot in the academic world. So so Jeff is still at the University of Toronto and but works at Google. Jan LeCun is at the is at NYU, but also is the director of Facebook AI Research Labs or Meta AI Research Labs. And Joshua started Element AI a number of years ago. It's also just worth pointing out that Geoffrey Hinton is he's the great-great-grandson of George Boole, who's the first professor of mathematics at UCC. Of course, you know, Ireland has a great heritage in AI. You know, the term AI was coined by John McCarthy. His father was McCarr Sabine. I mentioned George Boole and the Hinton connection. And Alan Turing's family, or his mother in particular, is actually Irish. For those of you sitting in Dublin right now, in Dublin 4, married in a church quite nearby. So tremendous, I suppose, Irish connections to the field of AI. And you know, the Boole Hinton story is very much a story of AI in a single family. So the invention of symbolic reasoning and symbolic logic. So how do you reason logically up to pattern recognition? And I suppose one of the things that we need to be aware of is, you know, what are the limitations of AI? And there's nothing that saddens me more than reading about AI on LinkedIn, for example, because I don't recognize it as the technology that I know. There's a lot of hype around AI. You know, we'll talk a little bit about that later. So I think there's a great degree of sort of cynicism needs to be put into the mind when you're reading some of the claims about artificial intelligence. We'll see some of that later. The term AI was invented in 1955 when John McCarthy and Marvin Minsky and others wrote the original proposal for the Dartmouth Research Project. You can actually search for this online. You find a PDF file of it. And it's interesting from a whole bunch of reasons. One reason it's very interesting is that the sense was, when it was written, that AI, that the features of artificial of human intelligence could be automated over the course of a single summer, and this is a sort of a key paragraph in the introduction. You know, if an attempt will be made to find out how to make machines use language abstraction concepts, solve all kinds of problems now reserved for humans and improve themselves, and they thought that a significant advance could be made in one or more of these from a carefully selected group of scientists, all of which were men, I should add, in one summer. And of course, these are exactly the problems that we still deal with in artificial intelligence today. Some progress has been made, you know, in some fields, great progress has been made, but the field is still very much, has largely the same ambitions. And, you know, what is artificial intelligence? I always describe it as the development of software technology that solves problems that are normally associated with the requirement of human intelligence. It's not about inventing robots to fool you into thinking that they're human beings, or to build sentient intelligent systems. So things like artificial consciousness, singularities, the notion of strong AI, these really are either thought experiments or philosophical concepts or science fiction. Nobody in the artificial intelligence community is working on artificial consciousness. And I think that's important to bear in mind. Of course, we talk about it because we come in contact with it in so many different ways. We're coming in contact with it right now because there's an AI algorithm that's moderating the speed of my voice so that you hear the words that I'm speaking at this end in the order in which I intend them to be heard at your end. I might be speaking slightly more quickly or slightly more slowly, depending on the speed of your internet connection, but that has all been taken care of by AI. You know, the image that's behind me is the lighting is being, the camera is taking account of the lighting environment so that you don't see me completely washed out. Those of you who have backgrounds, you know, AI has been used to copy every frame and make sure that that you appear in front of the background in a neat way in the next frame. And so, it's going on behind us all the time. I suppose the original big ticket successes were things like Deep Blue beating Garry Kasparov at chess, and IBM Watson beating human beings at Jeopardy, and in the last few years, AlphaGo beating Lee Sedol at the Go game. We're all aware of the hype around automated driving. And while obviously you can buy self-driving cars, I think you would have great fun putting them into self-driving mode on any sort of Irish road, apart from maybe the motorways. And there's very good reasons for that. There are significant ethical issues. So on the far right of this picture, you see Sophia the robot, who was given citizenship in Saudi Arabia. And so this raises lots of interesting issues, such as whether AI systems should ever have legal personhood, whether robots should have legal personhood. How do you regulate, or what do you do about AI systems that can invent? So who is the inventor? If I build a program that invents, then can I claim to be the inventor of that, or is the inventor the AI system? And who gets named on the patent? So that's these are issues that obviously the legal people on this call might have a view on. I suppose there have been some really challenging examples of the use of AI in Texas Hold'em and poker playing, and these don't tend to get a lot of airplay. But these, for me, are actually the most significant advances, because the ability of computers to simulate the process of bluffing and attack and essentially sort of psyching out the play, opposing players. And a colleague of mine, Thomas Antrim, built the Libretus system, which has which essentially is the most powerful Texas Hold'em player on the planet. No human being can beat that system. So it's been used in Las Vegas in competitions. It's not used online, because effectively the game becomes unfair. But I suppose one thing, there's two points I want to make about all of these different. So there's an application in the middle before I move on. This you see this mannequin, and you see these charts behind her. So this is an IC mannequin. Her eyes are cameras. She can use gaze. So it uses gaze detection to look where, to determine where you're looking. It can predict your gender, your age, your ethnic background. It has a sense of what you like on the mannequin, whether you like the shoes or the dress. It also can track you around stores, so that when you take the shoes to the cashier, she can say, well, did you see the blouse that's down on the mannequin with those? Wasn't that really nice and lovely? Wouldn't you want to buy that? This sort of thing. So major ethical issues going on here. Everything from who is responsible for AI systems when they go wrong. Sort of gender issues. Lots of AI systems that we use have female names. So Sophia is Sophia the robot. Siri is a lady's name. Cortana is a lady's name. And I think this isn't by accident. And I think, we do need to ask ourselves the questions, why aren't there more male names for AI systems? And I think there's a subtle sexism behind that, which we can talk about. But also, AI systems do not compare to human intelligence in the sense of they don't solve problems in the same way. To plug in the Libretus system and have it running through a typical tournament in Las Vegas, it costs about $50 million to run it on a the electricity bill for Libretus is about $50 million per fortnight. The AlphaGo system, while it beat Lee Sedol is he's a man in his early 30s. He's got a life. Whereas AlphaGo has been trained on the equivalent of about 5,000 human lifetimes of Go, playing Go every moment of those lifetimes at the speed of a supercomputer. Whereas Lee Sedol's brain, your brain, consumes about 20 watts of electricity. And so when you compare these what these systems can do is give you the impression that they're intelligent. But of course, they couldn't even power up with the amount of electricity that your brain is using to solve even the most complex problems. So, you know, to say that AI is becoming a solved problem isn't true. To say that AI is coming to take our jobs isn't true. If you find yourself being attacked by a killer robot, then you just need to close the door for about 20 minutes because by the time you've drank that cup of tea, that AI system has run out of battery and there's nothing more to worry about. And if that doesn't work, you could just, you know, paint a handle black because it won't be able to see it. So, you know, Amara's law definitely does apply. But of course, the technology has had massive impacts. So there's we can't underestimate that, right? But let's not just get too carried away. There has been a great story about AI in the fight against COVID-19. But I would caution you on this one that it is entirely hype. I would go so far as to say there are no AI systems that have succeeded in the fight against COVID-19. So I'll give you a sense of that in a second. So there are some interesting cases. So, you know, certainly there have been systems that have been built to classify radiography images as instances of COVID or instances of not COVID. And that's been quite interesting. But over the last few months, you know, there's a variety of pieces of research have been shown. So this, by the way, was a typical kind of thing that you would do with AI. You know, that image classification would be is a perfect example. So all the people who do convolutional neural networks over images to classify is this a dog or a cat, is this COVID, is this not COVID, certainly there's a lot of work has been done and published in very serious journals. You know, this is a paper that appeared in Nature Medicine. But in the last very recently, there has been, you know, very interesting reports going back over the work that has been published. And for example, this particular paper, which appeared in Nature Machine Intelligence very, very recently, I'll just highlight one particular line in the abstract. They've essentially reviewed about 2,200 studies of the use of artificial intelligence in the fight against COVID. You know, of which, you know, once they factor out ones that have some obvious deficiencies, they find in this review that there are none of those studies were of any clinical use. And that's because of methodological flaws, underlying biases. It's interesting when you speak to medics, they'll often say, well, yes, but, you know, that's kind of obvious, right? So they shouldn't have built these systems in this way. And I think what's really important when you're doing AI in deployed fields, that's important that you have AI experts sitting beside experts in the field. Because, you know, while I, as a computer scientist, might get very, very excited about the classification of CT images, and I know how to do that, there are all sorts of issues in the field that I need to be concerned about. And so while AI can be applied, it's not necessarily successful. What does success mean? And lots of other kinds of things we need to be concerned about. So the first, I suppose, the first take-home message is that you know, AI is this sort of technology that's so as Arthur C. Clarke said, any technology that's sufficiently advanced looks like magic. And there's a lot of discussion about AI that does give the impression that it is magical. It is not magical. It's a very simple set of algorithms and techniques that have been that can be used in a variety of different ways. Anyway, so one of the things we need to do when we're thinking about AI is to deal with data. So you know, Edward Deming said that in God we trust, but everybody else needs to bring data. Just very quickly, one of the projects I've been working on with the European Commission is an initiative called the AI Watch Initiative. So lots of charts here. I don't want you to read the charts. So just give you a sense of the project. So what we've been looking at is to measure the impact of AI, its uptake, where research activity is taking place, how public policy is impacting things. And we can do this at a global scale. So we look at the AI community through six different dimensions: AI services, vision, connected autonomous vehicles, machine learning methods, natural language processing methods, robotics and automation. We can look at the number of actors across various countries. We can look at, well, where has research been done? Has it been done in government institutions, research institutions, and companies? And for example, you know, you can start doing some analysis comparing countries. So this is just something I just quickly did, just pulling out the United Kingdom, Germany, France, Ireland, and Finland. So we can see, we can just compare those countries. And obviously, what's very interesting is that, well, first of all, what you'd expect is that the bigger the country, the more agents there are. There's nothing deep and meaningful there. So Finland and Ireland are roughly the same size. The UK is probably the leader in Europe in artificial intelligence, and obviously they have a significant number of activities. And I suppose the next question is, well, how do they compare with each other? And so what we can do is we can see against the sort of six types of AI that we're looking at, so services, vision, automated vehicles, and so on, we can look at, well, where is there a sort of world-leading advantage? And for example, we see that Ireland has a very, very strong reputation in natural language processing. Europe in general has a very strong reputation in AI services. Ireland is also very strong in computer vision. It's weak on connected autonomous vehicles. Most research is done in industry. Far less is done in research organizations, with the exception of machine learning, which tends to go on in research organizations less than firms. And, you know, if you think about it, that all makes sense. So, you know, in Ireland, there's significant startup activity and commercial activity in the use of vision systems. You know, those of you in Dublin, the M50, for example, all these cameras that are out there, you know, that these are commercially deployed. So, so Ireland does punch its weight primarily from the commercial sector. So I think a great success from Ireland's position with respect to the companies it has in the ecosystem, which is what you'd expect. I won't bore you with the detail, but you can go in far more detail. You can look at sectors, you can look at who's producing patents, where is the frontier research being done, all this other stuff. And so I won't go into the detail, but if you go to AI Watch on the Joint Research Centre website, just Google AI Watch, you'll find this service. And if you want any further information, just let me know. The big focus in Europe at the moment is on trustworthy human-centric artificial intelligence. And I think we've all heard the stories of bias and how algorithmic methods can have negative impacts. Cathy O'Neill's book, Weapons of Mass Destruction, I think is a really cracking title. There's all sorts of success failures. You know, Microsoft released a chatbot called Tay, which is also a girl's name, as I said at the very beginning. And that became that actively learned from watching people interact on Twitter, which of course we all know is not a good place to learn how to behave ourselves. You know, it did exactly what you'd expect it to do, and had to be removed. There's all sorts of concerns about bias. Now we need to be careful about what we mean by bias. Obviously, we don't want AI systems disadvantaging any sector of society, but we also need to be careful about what we mean by bias. So obviously there's data bias, you know, data needs to be gathered in a representative way. But of course, we do live in a very biased world. Whether we like it or not, women are disadvantaged in all sorts of ways. They're not represented as much as they should be in senior positions. The same is true of any other ethnic minority. Of course, when we learn from the world, we learn from a biased world. And of course, you know, the question is, well, how do you deal with that? And how we naturally deal with that is we fight the bias with bias. So we carry out interventions that ensure that we actively promote the participation of women, for example. And so we certainly don't want to remove bias from AI systems. We want to understand this and deploy it properly when that's necessary. So that's just something to bear in mind. I had the honor of chairing the high-level expert group for the European Commission, which I suppose today we're looking at the AI Act. And at the time, we In 2018, the Commission wanted to sort of get on this road of, well, what should we do about AI from a regulatory point of view? And so we developed a set of ethics guidelines for the European Commission, which are now official EU policy. It was a tremendous group of people, 52 experts from all over Europe, many of them corporate CEOs. So the corporate CEO of Orange was a member of the group. The tall gentleman in the center with the striped tie is the former president of Nokia Mobile Phones, former CEO of Nokia Mobile Phones. So Pekka chaired the group, and I was working with him in support of him with the group. The remainder of the group were people from academic circles, commercial circles, so BMW, Bayer, IBM, Siemens, people from the civil society sector, so legal experts, philosophers, so all sorts of people. And so it was a very interesting process. Over about 2 years, we developed a number of things. I suppose in the first year of our work, we produced the Ethics Guidelines for Trustworthy AI, which I'll talk about very briefly, which got a lot of attention. We also produced a set of policy and investment recommendations, which received less attention. But it's interesting to see that almost every national AI strategy that has been produced since is recommending the kinds of things that were in the policy and investment recommendations. So they could have saved themselves a lot of work by just adopting them. There's effectively nothing new in any national strategy that wasn't in either of these two documents. So I suppose just in terms of the regulation of AI and the ethics guidelines. So ultimately what we did was we identified seven key requirements that AI systems should have. So AI systems should protect human agency. They should be subject to human oversight. This gets back to the question of legal personhood. They should be robust and safe. They should protect, they should be governed properly. They should be transparent. They should avoid discrimination, protect environmental and societal well-being, and be accountable. For those of you who speak fluent general data protection regulation, if you look at these seven key requirements through the lens of personal data, you get the key tenets of the general data protection regulation. At UCC, we host the assessment list for trustworthy AI, which is a system that companies can use to evaluate AI systems. It may be down at the moment due to a server upgrade, but it'll be online again tomorrow. And I suppose the question is whether we should regulate AI or not regulate AI. So for the nerds in the room, this is the to regulate or not to regulate Boolean circuit. Obviously when Ursula von der Leyen became president, she wanted to introduce a regulation. She has done that essentially. She published a white paper on the regulation of AI in 2020. In that white paper, there were two dimensions, which I won't go into in a great degree of detail. But in April of this year, she published a proposed regulation for artificial intelligence, the Artificial Intelligence Act. The approach to regulation in Europe is a risk-based approach. This is following a recommendation from the high-level expert group. However, the high-level expert group did not recommend that we introduce a regulation. But the appropriate mechanism for regulating AI is to adopt a risk-based approach. And when the impacts of AI were sufficiently severe, that one may wish to adopt the precautionary principle. So what the Commission have proposed is that AI systems be classified on four levels, not necessarily mutually exclusive of each other. So there are systems that pose, I suppose, what does risk mean? Risk means essentially one of two things. Either the AI system must be robust and fit for purpose. And the second risk is that the AI system cannot pose any significant risks to the fundamental rights of individuals. So this is risk in terms of the European Charter of Fundamental Rights. And so there are certain things that are deemed unacceptable in the draft regulation. So things like mass citizen scoring, high risk applications are applications that do significantly impact your rights. So things like the use of AI for recruitment, for medical devices and so on. So these will be subject to significant surveillance and ex ante conformity assessments. AI systems that that are medium risk, and they are permitted, but they must be labeled. So, for example, chatbots or anything that might create hallucination in the vulnerable. So, for example, those suffering from Alzheimer's disease, very, very young people. People must always know that they're interacting with an AI system. And there are some AI systems that pose minimal or no risk. So, for example, the voice and video modulation that we're dealing with over the Zoom call as you're listening to me. So, so the things that are being prohibited are things like subliminal manipulation, exploitation of children, disabled people, general purpose social scoring, remote biometric identification, for law enforcement purposes. Now, this is, some of these are challenging. Like I chair an advisory board for Europol on a project called GRACE, which is focused on the use of artificial intelligence for the detection of child sex abuse material online, and to help find children who are trapped in the system that produces that. And the AI Act is something that places some restrictions on that. And obviously, as part of the debate, Europol need to ensure that they can fight crime while not having one hand tied behind one's back, but at the same time not compromising the fundamental rights of the innocent. And so these are very, very complex issues. There are a number of other things that are in the regulation, but I think just given the time, I'll finish there. And happy to answer any questions. And as I said to the chairs, I'm under no time restriction, so I'm happy to engage as much as possible. So thanks very much for the invitation to speak.
Barry, that's a really wonderful presentation. So I could listen to you all day on this stuff. And I say that as someone who does data protection all day, every day. So it's superb material, I must say. A few questions have already kind of come in, so I'm going to start off with a few of those. And one is about your own company, Stimul.ai, I think, because I'm interested in that. So as I understand it, that company has developed technology that has the potential to radically support hospitals and reduce waiting list times, which is obviously a massive societal good. And you won, you're too modest to say so, the MedTech Startup of the Year at the National Startup Awards. So well done. Could you tell us, just in practice, how AI could be used to solve an issue like that, where it's maybe potentially a motive and politically, you know, hot issue about waiting lists?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I suppose thanks for mentioning Stimul.ai. So it's a spin-out from UCC, and the CEO is a lady called Niamh McElhattan from the north of Ireland. So it's also a north-south startup, which is very nice. Mm-hmm. And so I suppose, look, there's a variety of ways of looking at waiting lists in hospitals. There's there's a strategic level and an operational level. I suppose most technologies for dealing with waiting lists are doing scheduling. So they're doing things like how do we schedule the porters, and how do we schedule the appointments so that the most urgent people get access first, and all that kind of thing. And these are very important technologies, but you need to design the service in a way that makes sure that the timing of clinics and the availability of clinical time and the policies around clinic design are well made. And that's what Stimul.ai does, basically. And so it's all about how you ensure that the design of the supply of the system is matched with the demands on the system, and that that you can answer the hard questions like, do you need, if you're running a radiology clinic, do you need more MRI scanners, or do you need to, open a little bit more often, maybe for a little longer? Are the do not attends that are the bane of hospitals' lives, are they a serious issue? And so basically what Stimul.ai does is it's built a technology that can help hospitals model their waiting lists at a strategic level and understand the impacts that different interventions can make. And so we've proven this in a variety of hospitals, and hopefully it'll do well. It'd be great to, our hospital waiting lists are getting worse and worse and worse. They are everywhere in the public system. And there are actually some very simple interventions that could be applied to fix that. And we can highlight those. We can demonstrate how to do that in an evidence-based way, how to resolve them in an evidence-based way. And so we'll see how we do.
Very good. Very good. I'm going to go to Professor Jonathan Wallace, who's got his hand up for a question next.
Thanks, Gene. Barry, good to see you again. Fantastic talk as always. Barry, I was at a conference last week and I actually thought you're the man to answer this question. So what came up in the discussion was, I mean, obviously from the research you and I have been involved in terms of digital health, it's very much around trust. So avoiding the black box situation so particularly the public understands why that decision was made, and rightly so. The question came back though, and we didn't get a really good answer for it, was if you have a situation though that typically explainable AI tends to be not as efficient as black box tech AI. So where, how do you draw that balance between efficiency that you get from a black box type machine learning type tool as opposed to making it explainable, for example? So you had to be the man who could answer that.
So sure. So I suppose just for the audience who don't know, typically the term black box AI applies to particular kind of machine learning systems that that make predictions or classifications, and that those systems are, it is difficult for those systems to explain why they've made that classification or made that prediction. And typically these are systems based on things like neural networks, deep neural networks, and so on. You know, Jonathan's highlighting the fact that there are other techniques that one can apply that are easier to explain. So for example, one of the most simple AI systems are systems called case-based reasoning systems, where they just remember previous experience. And when you're trying to make a diagnosis in the current scenario, you just retrieve your previous experience that was most like it and said, well, because I did this in the previous examples, I'm going to do it here. And of course, your previous experience is exactly the explanation for why you're doing it. So that's very, very transparent. I suppose two things about, I suppose, the specific question, I suppose, it isn't always the case that there's a huge difference in performance between black box systems and sort of more transparent white box systems. It really depends on the application, it depends on the setting. And sometimes it can be that while machine learning people really try to squeeze every percentage of accuracy out of a system, it can often be the case that because these tools will typically be used beside an expert, that, you know, sacrificing a couple of percent and using a white box system is a perfectly good thing to do. So I suppose I would always ask, why do you really want to use the deep learning system and the black box? You know, is it really necessary? And also, I suppose, look, the science of explainability and what's called XAI, explainable AI, is advancing all the time. And now there are techniques, of course, for helping explain these things. So I think this problem will go away in the long term. I think the big problem is ultimately going to be, I think the big challenge for AI is actually common sense. And what I mean is these learning systems, they don't have any model of the world. So they don't understand the world and they don't understand what causes what. And that's what I call common sense. And I think what we'll find is that the explainability problem is going to be, I think, solved very, very quickly. I think it's, you know, there's already been great progress, but I think the sort of trustworthiness that comes from systems having common sense and what the relationships are between things, I think that's going to become much more important, in fact. I'm not sure if that answers the question, John.
Oh, thanks, Brian.
Thank you.
And we have another question there that's actually closely aligned to the point that you made earlier, Barry, in relation to biases. Mm-hmm. And one of the questions that has come in is, how do we ensure that the inevitable biases that we build into these systems don't become hidden and impossible to change, impossible to manage once they're loaded within the systems? There's a $50,000 question. A lot more.
Yeah, I think obviously we need to be precise about what kind of bias we're talking about, right? So and what I mean is, like, there's a very famous example that is often given as an example of why bias is important to deal with, and this is the compass system for making parole recommendations in the United States. And there's a significant literature that suggests that African Americans are disadvantaged by that system as opposed to the white population. And that is certainly true for some definitions of bias. So, for example, are you more likely to believe that an African American is going to reoffend versus a white person? Or, you know, if you're going to make mistakes, if you're going to erroneously identify someone as likely to offend when they are not, unfortunately, that is an error that is more prevalent on the African American side than the white side. But there are other measures of bias where you find that the system is not biased. And so there's, you know, three types of bias that people talk about are things like false negative rates, so false positive rates, so precision and recall, and also what's called calibration. And you can, you know, mathematically prove that you can't eliminate all three simultaneously. So what you have to do essentially is have human oversight and human judgment. That's, you know, what is the acceptable mix of biases that we want to have, recognizing that the system can must be biased because the world is biased. And so and human beings are often quite good at this. You know, we like, if we think about, you know, the kind of interventions we've applied in to address the underrepresentation of women, we know that, you know, what things we can do. You know, we can you know, set quotas, we might debate about it, we might promote the thing more strongly amongst the female population, we might be more encouraging of female, there's all sorts of things we can do. And, you know, I think we all agree that are perfectly reasonable responses. So there are things that we can do as humans in oversight of these systems. Hidden biases are difficult to deal with. And of course, what we need to figure out is how to measure these things. How do we test for these sorts of properties? But I think once we reveal them, I think we can deal with them. And coming back to John's question, I think we also need to think about the need to be able to fix AI systems or repair AI systems in the presence of bias. And so we need to make sure that an organization who's using a particular technique like a deep neural network, that they have the resources to retrain that and to reproduce it. And as I said earlier, you know, when I was talking about Libratus and AlphaGo and so on, it isn't actually possible for any organizations to maintain these systems unless you're a Google. So, you know, the choice of what technique you use, where you use it, is as much the explainability question, which Jonathan raised, as much it is the maintainability and the bias repair problem that has been raised just now. Thanks.
And one issue that I come across, Barry, and I have had experience of advising the European Commission in the past, which we're allowed to say because it's public tender and all of that in relation to IP. One of the big things that you see in areas like AI, the question is always raised, should we regulate something? And what I like to say, only half jokingly, is that a lot of the time in Ireland, when you raise that question, the truth is the thing is already regulated and people maybe don't have a strong awareness of it. So a lot of the time you're putting, you're building layers of regulation on top of one another. And certainly in relation to kind of biases and things like that, my own view is that if you don't properly explain your biases built into a system, you won't pass the GDPR transparency requirement. So you won't be in compliance with that law. Now, it's only one law, but... Yep. You know, there might well be future regulation of AI and that would be a good thing. But I think for some of those things, if you don't address it and calibrate it properly and properly explain it in your privacy notice, then you won't be handling the data in a legally compliant manner in the first place.
Yeah, it's very interesting you raise this because when it comes to regulating AI, there's a variety of issues that we need to bear in mind. First of all, it's not an unregulated space. So lots of the kind of systems that we talk about, that you hear about when people talk about AI, they're using personal data. So the GDPR very much applies. And of course, again, going back to John's question about explainability, there are strong explainability requirements in the GDPR. There's also product liability regulation. You know, there's medical device regulation. You know, we might get onto this later, but one of the weaknesses of the AI Act is its definition of AI. Because despite the fact that John McCarthy and Marvin Minsky wrote the proposal in 1955, there still isn't an agreed definition of AI. And, you know, the best definition I can give you is you know, the software systems that solve problems that we normally associate with human intelligence. That's a very difficult thing, I would imagine, to argue in court. So is a system an AI system or not? Yeah. And I think that's a weakness in the AI Act that you don't have with the GDPR. It's clear what personal data is. It's not so clear what AI is. And the other odd thing about the AI Act, and I think just on the question of regulation, is that it regulates the means rather than the ends. So you know, you can build a system, you can build exactly the same system, one using AI techniques, another one not using AI techniques. The AI Act applies to one, doesn't apply to the other, but they can still have the same biases and everything else, as you know. So it's a very curious sort of situation, you know. So I think AI is heavily regulated, as all technology already is. And I think one of the big questions for the AI community is whether we need a general regulation for artificial intelligence or not. And I think it's going to be very complicated. So I think we're going to see a lot of change in this thing before it gets over the line.
Thank you. That's a very thoughtful response there too. I think it's very tricky landscape, really. Mm-hmm. And it would be easy if nothing was regulated at all. You're doing it from a blank sheet, you know. Huey Wang, and I hope I'm pronouncing your name correctly, has a question on the regulation pyramid. You mentioned social scoring being at the top. And can you clarify what it means precisely? There are statistics that are broken down by, I think, ethnic groups or ethical groups. Count as social scoring.
Yeah, so social, I suppose this is specifically a response to any form of surveillance that rates people according to their behavior. So, you know, for example, there are nations that do have systems that maintain scores of individual citizens. And so these scores are maintained automatically, so they can be impacted by, you know, your credit score, whether you've got parking tickets, whether you've behaved properly on the street, and all these sorts of things. So any form of mass surveillance where there isn't explicit informed consent will be forbidden in the EU. I think even if the AI Act isn't enacted, I think we're likely to see legislation specifically banning some of those technologies. So I think, you know, for example, there's a large scale citizen scoring program in China. Obviously there are different, you know, value systems and different sort of legal bases for different parts of the world. In the EU, such a system wouldn't be considered legal. I'm not judging in any way. I'm just simply stating the fact. And so it's systems like that. So so in fact, any camera, if you were to stick a camera on a lamppost in Ireland, and that was to identify, well, the guy in number 13 seems to be a troublemaker, and it maintains any sort of database like that whatsoever, that will be illegal in Europe.
As some county councils found out after they had spent a lot of money on installing.
Yes, that. Yes, indeed. So it's actually surprisingly easy to fall foul of some of these things.
No problem. I think we've someone else who had their hand up there. I'm just going to go scroll through the pictures. My screen doesn't show everyone. So I'm trying to see who had their hand up. I think did Aidan have his hand up?
Yeah, I see there's an Aidan Finnegan has his
Aidan,
hand up there.
Hi, Aidan. I think you had your hand up.
Hi, Professor O'Sullivan. Thanks for your time. It's been fascinating so far. You mentioned at the start of your presentation the disconnect that exists between the public's perception of what AI is and contrasted it with the fairly, for lack of a better word, mundane uses of it in the real world. Some people that are ostensibly quite bright, such as Elon Musk, frequently speak about AI in terms of science fiction and the existential threat that it poses to it. Is this concern born of ignorance, or do you think there's something else behind it, or how do you kind of explain that disconnect?
Why Elon Musk thinks about the things that he does? Stephen Hawking had the same view, that there is an existential threat, that AI poses an existential threat. I had the great honor once of meeting him and briefly discussing that with him. So he felt that very strongly. Others like Jan Tallinn, who was the founding engineer of Skype, really believes this and believes it so much that he has established all of his philanthropic investments are in studies related to the existential risk to humanity. And he really, you know, this is an extraordinarily bright individual. He really believes that this is something to be concerned about. I think it's sort of a misguided concern to some extent. Basically, the argument there is that, you know, the progress AI systems seem to be becoming more human-like with each passing day. They seem, you know, all of these complex and, you know, apparently challenging problems seem to be falling to AI at a rapidly increasing rate. And surely there will come a moment when AI systems are at par with human beings. And every moment after that, machines are more intelligent and therefore, you know, they can outwit us and so on. I must confess, I don't believe that argument at all. Like, as I said to you, you know, if you find yourself being accosted by a killer robot in the street, just close the door, have a cup of tea. The battery will be dead by the time you're finished your cup of tea. But the sophistication of the kind of reasoning that is required to be able to solve these types of strong, intelligent problems is not something that's even been studied. You know, the AI community is a community of people who work on very specific problems, like the ability to plan, and in very, very tightly controlled areas. The AlphaGo system can play AlphaGo and nothing else. Like, sure, there are game playing systems that can learn how to play games and do it very, very well. I think, you know, you've all probably seen the videos of Boston Robotics, robots that look awfully human and awfully sort of scary. What they don't tell you is that usually these videos take hundreds, if not thousands, of shots to try and get that particular thing. And while they're extremely impressive, literally nobody in the technical world is working on things that have existential threats. However, there are threats that are posed by AI systems, and I think we need to be very careful about those, because I'll give you a very mundane one. There are email systems now that propose responses to emails for you to help you reply to your emails, right? So some of these responses are perfectly good, but some of them are not. Some of them are dangerous to send in those particular settings. They might be offensive, or they just might be the wrong thing to do, and that can have an impact, right? So there are some threats, but we have to be very careful about how we apply the technology. In the military domain, there are risks because AI systems that are used in military settings can completely inadvertently create situations where states find themselves in states of war. So there are major impacts, but I think Elon Musk and others, I think they really, I think they see AI in the strong AI sort of artificial consciousness sort of sense. And, you know, I think it's useful to think about that. You know, there's very fine philosophers who are thinking about this, but I really don't think it's anything that any of us need to worry about in our lifetimes. And I think we could tell our kids and our grandkids that they can take that to the bank as well.
I remember a few years ago, a young lawyer saying to me, do you not think, and I was much younger then, do you not think you might not get as far as retirement because the robots will come in and take the boring part of our jobs? To which my genuinely sincere response is what it is then, now, which is roll on the robots taking on the boring parts of our jobs and allowing us charge more money, frankly, for the higher end work that we all do. So I'll welcome a team of robots that'll take anti-laundering compliance away from my desk.
Well, and of course, you know, robots have taken away the drudgery, you know, like for those academics in the room, you know, and for those non-academics in the room, like, how many times do we resort to Google to help us find a piece of information, you know? So it's not that, like, I don't know about you guys, but I don't find myself having more time to do other things for some reason. So, like, it's not as if I'm finding that enormous amounts of my time is freed up by all that automation.
I think it's better for that for me.
Yeah, it's never been the case that technology has, like, what's the purpose of technology? I think the purpose of technology is to remove friction. And just because we remove certain, you know, once we remove some friction, it doesn't mean that we don't discover that there's another source of friction, you know. So I think, you know, I don't think we need to be worried about job replacement. You know, certainly our jobs will change, and our jobs have changed. You know, how we, like, you know, when I started out doing research, people used to post research papers to each other. You know, I think I can't remember the last time that a researcher posted a paper to me. It's certainly not in the last 20 years. You know, that's just how the job has changed a little bit, but the fundamentals of the job haven't changed. And of course, you know, as you say, like, there are very significant you know, the state of AI is basically, you know, not even equivalent to the ability of a very young child, you know. So, you know, so, like, sure, you can search databases, you can search through vast amounts of information, you can train them to do things like this, but, you know, that's pretty much the extent of it. You know, making a judgment about something is something that is, that will, I think, will always require a human being, if at least it is to be ethical.
Very good. And before I pass you on to Paul, because I think some questions sure. come directly to Paul, so I'm going to ask him, I'm going to be very selfish and ask you a question.
Sure.
Have you yet had an opportunity, a two-part question, as they always do in conferences, I won't preface it with, it's more of a statement. Number one, have you had a chance to read Clara and the Sun yet? And if you have not, how many copies do you expect to be gifted at this Christmas?
I have read Clara
and the Sun. I would say 12.
Yeah, I have read Clara and the Sun. And,
did you enjoy it?
I did. I really liked it, and I think. But then, you know, anything you know that he writes, I love. I think my favorite of his is Never Let Me Go. I'm not sure if you've read that one. Yeah, so that's my favorite one. I think Clara and the Sun is excellent. If you enjoy that book, I'd also recommend Ian McEwan's book, or what's it called,
People Like Us or something else. Books like
yes, us. yeah people like us. Yeah, it's a, yeah. It's a really fantastic book.
I haven't read it yet,
but there are lots of very, there are I think it really gets at the question of it's really interesting, because like AI has been in literature for hundreds of years, you know, the like Mary Shelley wrote Frankenstein, you know, just more than 200 years ago, and that's a story about, you know, bringing in, you know, introducing intelligent life and the responsibility that comes with that, and what happens when you don't live up to those responsibilities. And you know, there's been many other stories like that. So, you know, Clara and the Sun is a fantastic book, and, you know, highly recommended.
Very good. I guessed you might like it. There you go. Paul, do you want to raise any of the questions that have been raised direct to you?
Yeah, I will absolutely do that in a second. But I think Gavin Murray has it's a longer question, so I might ask Gavin to put it directly to Professor O'Sullivan. And then I have a couple of questions that have been sent to me. And then I think we'll wrap up about 5:10, if that's all right with everyone. So, Gavin.
Yeah, thank you very much, Paul. Sorry, it is quite a lengthy question, so I'll try and keep it brief. I suppose, and thank you for that talk, that was really interesting. I noted at the start you addressed that there was an issue determining who was at fault where an AI system fails or a malfunction. And in consideration of this, with autonomous systems, for example, autonomous vehicles, where the final product consists of a variety of pieces of autonomous technology working usually symbiotically, have you any examples or any case references of where manufacturers and software engineers navigated this minefield in terms of product liability? Or are we too early of a stage in implementing AI?
It's a very good question. So, like, obviously, I'm not a legal expert, but the like in the regulation, in the upcoming AI regulation, it's interesting that that liability is envisaged not to lie necessarily with the producer of the system, but with the organization who introduces the system onto the market first. I think that's really interesting, because that's a very sort of a smart sidestep to the fundamental issue that you're raising, which is, when you bring all of these systems together, who is responsible for the whole? And you know, the AI Act envisages that the organization that brings that system onto the market is responsible. And I think that's really, really interesting. There have been lots of examples of, in the autonomous vehicle case, for example, if you look at the kind of catastrophic outcomes in some of the Tesla crashes, some of these have been a consequence of the AI system malfunctioning, and some have been a consequence of misuse. So, for example, I think the very first, you know, there's been a number of crashes where effectively the user was misusing the system by, you know, in a self-driving Tesla, you're always supposed to have your hands in the wheel. You are supposed to be paying attention, except you're letting the car do the hard work, which is different from, you know, putting the car into automated driving mode and going to sleep or reading a book. And in a couple of cases, it was shown that the driver who subsequently who died in the accident wasn't did not have his hands on the wheel and so on. So I suppose in these cases there is an element of human misuse, but of course, you know, where does the liability lie there? I'm sure the legal people in the room would, you know, I think it's a pretty standard liability question. You know, what happens, who's liable if the person misuses a product in a way that harms them? And I think the fact that it might be an AI system or not doesn't really, is not a significant issue there. It's mm-hmm. just the use of the system itself. I think it's when we buy AI artifacts, there's also, you know, you can buy different types of AI artifact. You can buy systems that are, that, you know, exhibit intelligence. So for example, you know, good old fashioned recommender systems or the you know, systems that you interact with in cars, for example, sort of wave features for turning the volume up in the car, safety features like occupancy, alertness and so on. Like most high-end cars these days, they do have some sort of driver monitoring, you know, using cameras and so on. In those systems, I think the you know, my understanding is that the conventional wisdom is that it's the person who builds this system and configures the system and puts it on the market is the one that is responsible. Obviously, if one can prove that there was some, in some way, the production of the system, of that particular artifact, that there was some negligence in the development of the system, then there are going to be problems, and you know, there's liability issues there. But it becomes really, really challenging. I think it's also linked to the whole question of legal personhood. So there was a debate for a while that AI systems might become sort of you know, persons in their own right, or sort of legal entities in their own right. And that's, I'm not quite sure what the legal view is on that, but the ethical view in it is that that's not considered ethical, because there must be a human, or I suppose a corporate entity that, you know, that does have human beings at the core that can turn up in court and defend themselves against it and answer for it.
So case through the courts, you know.
Yeah, exactly. So that person still must be a human being, as I understand it. So that's why, you know, the whole Sophia the robot as an individual with a passport and Saudi citizenship and everything was a real kind of was a real controversy. And interestingly, in the EU, Malta is the only EU member who has suggested that they might give legal personhood to AI systems, which I'm not sure what the current state of that is. They raised this about a year and a half ago. Oh, sorry, 2.5 years ago. COVID has, I've lost the year to COVID. So 2.5 years ago, so during 2019. And I think that raised some considerable objections from the European Commission. So I'm not sure if that quite answers all of your question, but you know, the AI Act does try to envisage a particular structure for that and a particular liability regime for that.
Yeah, it does. Thank you very much. And just interesting on that point with the legal entities, it has been suggested by some academics to view autonomous entities or autonomous vehicles, to view them from a legal standpoint, similar to dogs or canines, in that the owner, while not responsible for all their actions, is the end party, I suppose, responsible for the outcome.
Yeah, that is interesting. I suppose, you know, and this comes back to the sort of human in the loop and everything. I suppose, like, if you, you know, just sort of building on that, you could imagine that one buys an AI product that allows you to train it, for example. So, you know, if you bought some sort of let's see, what would be a good example? You had a bot representing you online that could you know, manage your calendar, for example, and you had taught it a set of rules that were in some way dangerous, or, you know, if it was for a hospital consultant who then, you know, for some reason just wasn't dealing with patients in the way that he or she should, then I suppose the, you know, it raises an interesting question: is the person who trained that system responsible for its misuse? And I think there's some credibility in that. I think that's certainly interesting. And but ultimately, there must always be a human who is responsible, I think, is the principle.
Apologies. Just conscious of time, we have two more questions that I think have come into Paul. So we're going to jump to Paul Liner, if that's okay.
Hi, Jean. How are you? And thank you again, Professor O'Sullivan. Just to clarify, we have quite a number of questions. So a big apologies to everybody. We, again, can't get to you. It's actually a fault of mine. I only put an hour down for this, and I know we're over time. So we should have really done 90 minutes, Professor O'Sullivan. So thanks to me for a very interesting talk.
I could talk all day about this. And
it seems that people are asking, could ask questions all day as well. So we have a good balance. So we might bring you back again in the new year. In relation specifically to your own research field, somebody has asked, where does Ireland stand in terms of the effort and, I suppose, the development of AI technology? And what can we do to move up the ladder, especially in comparison to other peers that we can learn from, such as the UK? So that's one question. I'll probably put all three to you, if I may.
Sure. Okay.
The second one is, what AI technologies are you most excited about going forward? And is there any companies that we can keep a close eye on? I suppose that could be, you could be betting on the stock exchange there. People could be asking for a tip there. And then the last one I'll take, and again, I apologize to everybody if it's not a bias, but is the AI Act sufficient in your view for a sector that's developing so quickly? So I'm sorry to put three of them at you so quickly,
okay.
But I think...
No problem at all. So let me see if I can get some. So the research in Ireland. So Ireland has a great reputation in many areas of AI research. So, and in fact, I think it's world leading in several. Mm. So so for example, in my own field, the founders of the field, the people who created the conferences and the communities around them, these are people working in Ireland. So the constraint programming community, for example, is one that Ireland can claim significant ownership of and is recognized internationally in that way. The recommender system community is very, very strong in Ireland. I think we are doing world leading research there also. In areas like case-based reasoning, in video processing, we're doing very good work. I think we certainly can stand up internationally very well there. The big challenge we have in exploiting that in a way that moves Ireland up the ladder a little bit is just trying to get the technology adopted. There's a great, for all sorts of reasons, while many companies in Ireland are adopting AI. And I mean, I'm really talking about the SMEs here rather than the multinational sector. I think, we could do more. And I think primarily the reasons why there are challenges there is uncertainty about the technology itself. And so how do I use it? Some uncertainty, some reticence because of the regulations and the sort of risks and so on. But I think ultimately the big issue is skills and just having the availability of people. So I think there's plenty of opportunity. There's great opportunities in areas like agriculture, in tourism. I think there are some sectors that Ireland could really become world leading in artificial intelligence that it isn't working in right now. So for example, Ireland has a million square miles of ocean. One of the greatest opportunities and one of the most significant areas of AI deployment in the United States is in space exploration. And the closest thing to space is deep sea. And so Ireland has a massive opportunity to become a test bed for what I call embodied artificial intelligence systems, so AI and robotics for exploration. And I think if we could harness that, I think we could really become not only a world leader in the development of that technology, but we could become the place where people come to do it. And just in conversations I've had with colleagues, my professional mentor is Ken Ford. He's the former chair of the NASA Advisory Council. I've chatted to him on a number of occasions about this, and he seems to believe that this is a great opportunity. There are people who working at HUI and other exploration area, they think that this is a great opportunity. But I think, look, coming back to the SMEs, the big challenge is skills and how do you get people comfortable with the concepts and conversant in the concepts. But Ireland is also not unique in that. So I think obviously we need to continue to invest in research, particularly exploratory research, make sure that we can compete in the development of the core science. I think companies will adopt the technology. I think the adoption barrier in commercial world is skills related. So that's just my tuppence worth. What AI technology am I most excited about at the moment? I'm very excited about the use of AI technology in public services, AI technology in policing. So as I mentioned at the beginning, I chair an advisory board for Europol on the use of AI for fighting a particular kind of serious crime in the area of the production and detection of child sex abuse material online. I think the use of AI for detecting instances of cyberbullying, for safety, for identifying disinformation, fake news. I think these are all interesting because they're not only important, but they're also very, very technically difficult. So I think the technologies that you apply there, everything from machine learning to planning to visualization, I think these are really exciting technologies. What companies, it's a hard one. There are lots of amazing AI companies. However, you know, I'm not, like, obviously I could say my own, but there are really some really exciting companies, you know, in Ireland and at a European level. But I suppose rather than plugging any particular one of them, I think we need more AI companies, you know. And I don't mean just in Ireland, I mean in Europe as a whole. I think Europe is lagging behind the United States significantly in AI startups. And I think anything we can do to facilitate the creation of those kinds of companies would be incredibly important. There's a really serious concern that we should have around the digital sovereignty of Europe, that we don't want to become merely a purchaser of other people's AI technology. Not that there's anything wrong with other people's AI technology, but we do want to have our own. And I suppose the AI Act, I think the question was, is the AI Act sufficient for
a technology that's developing as fast?
I think the AI Act has a number of issues. One big issue is it's not easy to define what AI is, and I think there's a serious issue when you're trying to regulate something that you can't define. The other issue is that I think it gets it wrong in that it doesn't regulate the harm that's done. It regulates the harm only when the harm is perpetrated by a system that's built in a particular way. And I think that doesn't sit quite right with me. So I think it's a little early. I think things like the medical device regulation, I think the GDPR, I think these are all excellent pieces of legislation. And I think we do need these sort of sector specific and domain specific pieces of regulation. I'm not so sure about a general purpose AI Act because even at the on the very first page, I think that the scope of it is very, very difficult to tie down to the point where I'm not even sure that it's really possible. Like I know a lot of companies in Europe that I speak to regularly, and what they're saying is that they're actually no longer describing themselves as AI companies or their technologies, AI technology, just simply to circumvent the scope of this regulation, which is also not a good thing because, you know, we do want people to be investing in AI research and we want AI research to be seen positively, not negatively. So I was involved in some of it to the extent of the high level expert group work, and I've consulted with the commission on a variety of different aspects of it, but it's certainly not there yet. So I think we're going to see a huge amount of change in the scope of that. And I think it's going to be many years before we see it introduced. So it is very important that everybody who's on this call and everybody who, you know, at every opportunity does feed into the process. My experience of dealing with the commission, I'm sure Jean would agree that they're very open to criticism, they're very open to feedback. And so it's very important that we are very active in feeding back to them. I think that's all four of the questions, Paul, is it?
Yeah, thanks, Barry. Sorry for gilding the lily there.
I think, Barry, we'll all agree, but it's wonderful that we have someone of your caliber at the table for those conversations. And particularly someone I think that has, as the people you mentioned, the very first part of your slide, people that have a foot both in academia and in industry. I think it's just great to have all of that kind of dual perspective, and to have you at the table is fantastic.
Anytime.
I won't take up any more of your time. I want to thank you on wholeheartedly on behalf of everyone here. I think we've all found this to be really excellent information passing. Okay. You're obviously a natural born teacher as well as an expert in AI.
I'm not sure about
the ability to, you know, don't they say that the person that deeply understands something can explain it in a way that is very digestible, and you've certainly managed to do that. And we'll certainly keep in touch. We'd love to have you back for the committee again. And again, just to thank you for your time this afternoon. It's been phenomenal.
It's been great. Thank you so much. And no problem. And I've put my email address and my Twitter handle. Feel free just to reach out anytime.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Professor Sullivan.
Thanks, my pleasure.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, everyone.